Coming up on Sportscast, Game 5 at the Sky Dome. Ricky and the A's eye the World Series. In the National League Championship Series, it's Gorelts against Maddox in Game 4 at the Stick. And the CFL, John Gregory and the Riders eye the 500 mark in Calgary.
Sportsdesk is brought to you by Canadian Airlines. Our world revolves around you. And by Labatt Blue. It's the way we play. Sportsdesk with Paul Romanek and Gino Retta.
Hello there and welcome to Sportsdesk. Well, the Toronto Blue Jays saw a light at the end of the tunnel on Friday when they finally won a game in the American League Championship Series. Optimism was abounding, but that light turned out to be on the front of a train coming right at them to run their season right off the track.
You know, Paul, there's not much more we can say. The Blue Jays trailed 3-1. To come back to win it, they would have to win the next 3 games in a row. To do that against Ricky Henderson and the Athletics was just too much to ask. Henderson has been the story. He leads the series in almost every offensive stat, including on-base percentage, runs scored, and steals. And on Sunday, well, the story was no different at all. Ricky Henderson leads off the game with a walk, then he steals second. That's his 8th stolen base of the series, a new Major League postseason record. Ricky Henderson always comes back to haunt you, as usual. Jose Canseco fists a single to center on an 0-2 pitch. Henderson comes in to score, and Oakland led 1-0. Then in the bottom of the second inning, the Jays have men on second and third. Dave Stewart gets Junior Felix to ground out, killing the threat. That's so typical of what the Blue Jays did in this series. We go to the top of the third, the A strike again with Walt Weiss on second. Who else but Henderson wraps one that goes all the way to the wall. The only thing Henderson hadn't done in this series yet was hit a triple. He does it here. Weiss scores easily, 2-0 Athletics. Top of the seventh, Athletics have runners on first and third. Terry Steinbach singles to shallow left. That scores Dave Henderson, 3-0 Athletics, and that spells the end of the road for Dave Steve. Bottom of the eighth inning, Stewart is still pitching shutout baseball, but with a single swing of the bat, Lloyd Mosby takes Stewart deep and out of the ballpark. It was 4-1 Oakland. Then top of the eighth inning, Jays keep coming down 3 runs. George Bell leads off the inning with a solo homer to left. That'll be it for Stewart. The A's lead now cut to 4-2. So you bring in the stopper. Dennis Eckersley comes in to close the door with Oakland leading 4-3. Junior Felix at the plate. He swings through the pitch. The Oakland Athletics win the American League Championship Series for the 2nd year in a row. The final again in this one was 4-3. Oakland wins the series 4-1. Ricky Henderson was named the American League Championship Series Most Valuable Player. No surprise. He really was the catalyst in the Oakland success.
You know, it's just like a dream come true, you know. As hard work you put in this game and trying to achieve to get to the World Series, you know, it's finally paid off. So I'm very happy, very pleased, you know. Right now, I don't know how to think or you know, feel, because it's a shock to me right now.
You know, it wasn't as easy as it looked. You know, the couple of those ball games, you know, we went 6-3, 7-4, whatever it was. You know, it just opens up in one inning. It wasn't that simple. And it was tough winning ball games here. You know, after the first night here, they got all fired up, and they were fired up all the way through. So I give Toronto a lot of credit. They got a great ball club.
It was an unbelievable season. Our pitching staff battled back. Our hitters battled back. It wasn't until the last couple of weeks of the season that we started clicking together, and we showed it here in the playoffs.
We've been trying to go all the way this year. I think from the experience we had last year, I think we're going to be able to capitalize on that. Even though we entered the World Series, we didn't win the World Series, I think this year's going to be a different story.
The Blue Jays season is over. They obviously didn't go as far as they would have liked, but they went further than a lot of people thought they would have gone. The Jays got a lot of negative press this year, but in the end, they gave their fans lots to cheer about. Mark Jones has the story.
Critics say the Toronto Blue Jays are quitters, that they're underachievers, but not the 1989 edition. Fans wanted to run Lloyd Mosby out of town just months ago, but it was Mosby who answered the wake-up call for the Jays in the 8th inning with a home run.
At that point, you know, Dave don't want to walk me, I know that, so he was just trying to, hopefully I hit another ball hard or something and right at somebody. That's the tactics of Dave Stewart. He was not walk you, and he did a fantastic job, and we got to give him a lot of credit. He came out and he fought and he clawed, and even though we hit him hard and we had him on the ropes, we couldn't knock him out.
The slumping George Bell followed with a blast in the 9th. But the Jays fell short. Bell and Freddie McGriff going a collective 7-for-41 for the series. A severe power shortage at the worst possible time.
The only advantage is in the 80s. Baseball's, you know, baseball game habits. You know, they got bench scout all over the place now. And they see me play last month and a half of the season, and they don't try to pitch me. They pitch me around and then pitch me a lot of outside, and they consistently pitch me inside, and I think that's why they get me out so easy.
In the past, the Blue Jays have been accused of not having any heart. But if nothing else, the last 3 weeks has proved that there is still plenty of blood pumping in their veins.
I think this club has learned a lot that, you know, they have a lot of weapons on this ball club. And I've learned that they had a lot of weapons in this ball club. And I think this series has shown that this club can do a lot of things. And those things are definitely going to, there's something for this club to build on.
I was proud to play on this team this year. Got a great bunch of guys. They worked hard. We never gave in. We never gave up. And we just kept going, kept plugging along. And you know, we got into the playoffs. A lot of people didn't think we were going to make it. I was saying a while ago, you got to take something positive home with you, I think, over the winter. You can't dwell on all, any of the negatives. I'm going to go home and think about, you know, hey, we did come from last place and got into first place, and we gave it our best shot, and we just fell short.
The truth is, Toronto lost to a better team, but this will be a season that Blue Jay fans will long remember. They moved into a new home here at the Sky Dome. Jesse Barfield was traded to New York, and Jimmy Williams was fired. Now, when Cito Gaston took this team over at 12-24, he told them in a closed-door meeting to go out and win for themselves. And they did, 77 more times during the regular season. And in doing so, Toronto scored big not only in the win column, but in the pride column. Mark Jones, TSN, Toronto.
A tempest in a teapot? Maybe, but there was sure a lot of steam coming out of the ears of Cito Gaston after the game. In the ninth inning, maybe in a bit of gamesmanship, he went out to point out to the umpire that he thought A's reliever Dennis Eckersley was hiding some sandpaper in his glove. I'll let Gaston pick it up here.
Eckersley, he had some in his glove, and he stood right there with me, and I said, don't turn around, watch him. And he watched him, he took it out of his glove. He started to put it here, he dropped it on the ground, picked it up, put it down here, and he never questioned it. Once he goes out and look at it now, I mean, it's gone. He put it in here, he can't undress it. But the bad part of that thing is, that's my job to do that, and he called me a bad name out there. Yeah, he would not cross that line in combat, because he's a half a woman anyway. Excuse me.
I thought he was, you know, trying to upset me, and it did. I thought he was trying to provoke me, and I'm sorry if I said anything, you know.
Yeah, did you compliment him?
I swore at him, and so I feel badly for doing that. But you know, I apologize right now. I mean, I have apologized, but you know, you do a lot of things out of with a lot of emotion, and that was a heck of a time to do something.
Well, heading into the National League Championship Series, pitching was expected to play heavily, and it has, but not exactly the way people expected it to. During the regular season, two pitching staffs with good ERAs, around 3.30 just to round it off. In the playoffs, though, the pitching has played so heavily because it's been so bad, unexpectedly, I might add. Remember that good old 3.30 regular season ERA I mentioned a second ago? Well, you can about double that for both teams so far in the playoffs. It has been certainly unusual. Luis Salazar facing Scott Goreltz, the National League ERA leader, 2.28, 14-5, and that didn't look like a pitch from a 14-5 pitcher. The Cubs lead 2-1, and the Giants fans follow the lead of the fans at Wrigley by throwing the ball back. Here's Greg Maddux, the Chicago pitcher, 2.95 ERA during the year, but the bases are loaded here. He's loaded them up. Then Matt Williams comes through, Butler scores, Will Clark scores, and it's 3-2 for the Giants. Maddux is gone in the fourth. Goreltz problems continue in the fifth. He only lasts 4 2/3 innings, gives up 4 runs, including this one here. Andre Dawson with the double to bring in Mark Grace. We're tied at 4, that's it for Goreltz. Fifth inning, Steve Wilson, another guy struggling against Matt Williams. A 2-run shot from Matt Williams, 6-4 for the Giants. Giants aren't out of the woods yet, though. Ninth inning, 2 on, 2 out, 2 strikes. Andre Dawson against Steve Bedrosian. And Bedrock is one guy who isn't struggling on the mound. He is the exception rather than the rule in this series. 6-4, San Fran over top of Chicago. Now afterwards, Matt Williams, who hit that big home run, as surprised as anyone that a struggling Steve Wilson stuck around to pitch to him in the fifth inning.
I don't know what's going through Zim's mind. I know that he's got confidence in Wilson. He's got a good live fastball. He's got good breaking stuff and an off-speed change that really affects right-handed hitters. I'm glad that he didn't walk me. It turned out that I was able to contribute to the win, but he's got confidence in him, and I think that's why he stuck with him.
He could hit a lot of home runs, as you saw. You know, I thought that was one of the best at-bats I've ever seen today with him and Wilson, and it was just outstanding because he fouled off about 7 or 8 pitches. He got a pitch to hit, and he hit it in a very crucial, crusher situation.
And it looks like an all-Bay World Series. Still to come on Sports Desk, NFL football highlights.
And Sunday night in the National Hockey League. Coming up on Sports Desk, look away across the bay. A World Series is coming your way. The Montreal Canadiens and the Boston Bruins, Pat Burns against Mike Milbury. And Edmonton looking to wrap it up in the CFL West as they play the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
Sports Desk is brought to you by Canadian Airlines. Our world revolves around you. And by Labatt's Blue. It's the way we play. Sports Desk with Paul Romanek and Gino Retta.
Hello, everyone. Nice to have you with us. A couple of great matchups in the NHL, including the Canadiens and the Bruins. Two games in the CFL with playoff implications. But first, game number 5 in the National League Championship Series.
And a game that was a great example of all the big factors in the series. Number 1, Will Clark's hitting, the difference for San Francisco, not much arguing that. Number 2, Chicago base running errors. Those throws of the dice that worked wonderfully during the season came up snake eyes in the playoffs. And number 3, Andre Dawson. For a number 5 hitter, he really did let Chicago down. And here's a perfect example of that early in the ball game. Rick Rushel facing Dawson, men on the corners. Dawson left 14 runners on base during this series. 14. Meanwhile, Mike Bielecki looking pretty sharp for the Cubs. Will Clark goes down swinging. Yeah, Will Clark, remember that name. The Cubs strike for a bizarre run here in the third. Jerome Walton, fly ball, and Kevin Mitchell blinded by the light. E7. Now the next batter is Ryne Sandberg, and I talked about Chicago base running errors. Looky here, he slaps one, and he is going to try to stretch it. One run comes in to score. Sandberg gets greedy, probably shouldn't have, and here comes the throw, and that'll do it. 1-0 Chicago. Cubs look to score again in the fourth. Runners on first and third, and double play. Thank you very much, Sean Dunston, grounding into that. In the fourth, Bielecki still looking strong. And most umpires, when you appeal, punch their arm for a strike. This guy scratches his heel. That's a strike. Bottom of the 7th. Giants finally rally. Will Clark, who else would it be? A leadoff triple. He was later scored on a sacrifice to tie the game at 1. So we'll go to the bottom of the 8th inning. Bielecki gives up 3 walks. Mitch William comes in. Will Clark. And Clark, with one of the 13 hits in the series, he batted 650. Candy Maldonado and Brett Butler come in to count. It's 3-1 and start to dim the lights. Steve Bedrosian comes in, trying to close it for the Giants, but a little bit of brightness for the Cubs. Jerome Walton with a single, Curtis Wilkerson with the run. It's 3-2. Now, Ryne Sandberg, 2 on, 2 out.
Breaking ball hit to Robbie Thompson.
And Steve Bedrosian nails down his 3rd save of the series. The Giants celebrate like the champions they are. They are off to the World Series against the Oakland A's, a Bay Area World Series. The first time we've had a Subway-type World Series since 1956 when the Brooklyn Dodgers played the New York Yankees. I think the Yankees won that one. San Francisco onto the World Series. After the game, Will Clark, the MVP, recalling speaking with Kevin Mitchell just before he faced Mitch Williams in the decisive 8th inning.
He said, "You remember this guy?" And I said, "Yep, sure do." And he said, "Well, just get the job done." I said, "It's done."
As you well know, Joe being a manager, 2-out walks kill you. And that was the name of the game. You know, getting the media to order up there with runs in scoring position. That's been the whole key to this whole series. So, glad we got the job done.
Yeah, I hate to see Will Clark strolling up there because he's buried us this whole series. But we had a lot of confidence in Mitch. He's been the guy that's bailed us out of those situations all year long. And he fought off some nasty pitches and got the pitch he wanted, and he didn't miss it. He showed today why, in my opinion, he's the best player in baseball.
Oh, this is much more important. You know, we were up 3-1 yesterday, but today we did it. Today we clinched it, and this feeling right now is much more important than any home run feeling ever.
Any instructions for Williams when he was pitching to Clark?
No, I never. He's saved 36 games for us this year, and I've never instructed a pitch this year, and I wasn't going to start today.
When you're aggressive like I am, you're not patient, then you're your own worst enemy. And, you know, that's when, you know, I'm at my worst. And I can be real bad when I try to force things instead of taking what they give you.
Had my stop right there. When I went to the mound, I said, "Hey, I want to make sure you feel okay." I didn't care what he said to me. I just want to say the way he said it, how he answered me. He answered me with so much intensity, so much fire that I said, "You got it, big boy, let's go." And he got the big out.
Ricky Henderson definitely dominated the American League Championship Series. In the National League, the hero was definitely San Francisco's Will Clark. I mean, just take a look at his stats through the series. Clark was 13 for 20. That's a National League playoff record. He had 2 homers, 8 RBI, 4 thanks to his grand slam in game number 1. All in all, he had 24 total bases. Definitely an MVP performance by Will Clark. There was a freak injury in the post-game celebration. Giants left-hander Dave Dravecki suffered a possible dislocated left shoulder when a teammate ran into him as the Giants were running to congratulate Steve Bedrosian. Just under a year ago, Dravecki had a cancerous tumor removed from his pitching arm, but he fought back to pitch this season, but broke his arm in his second game on August the 15th. But you can bet he will be back. So Will Clark will lead the San Francisco Giants to Oakland for game number 1 of the World Series next Saturday. The contrast between the winners and the losers at this time of the year is pretty dramatic. That was definitely the case after Game 5 in the American League Championship Series.
We hit the ball well. We just didn't have any luck with it. That's all.
Not to make any excuse, but the way that's going to play about.
There were several keys to this series, the most obvious being Ricky Henderson. The Jays knew they had to keep him off the base paths, yet he still managed to get on base 60% of the time. He also either scored or drove in almost half of Oakland's runs.
His on-base percentage, I don't know what it was, but I'm sure it was 609. I mean, that's quite high. So you put a guy on base like that that many times, he's going to affect the ball club.
He was the difference in the series?
Oh, no question. He was the difference. And going into the series, I said, to me, the key was keeping him and Carney off base, because you can put up with solo home runs, but you get him on base, he makes things happen.
And if you want to pick out one particular point that was the deciding difference in the series, is Ricky Henderson. That is the pivotal player. He is the player that made the biggest difference.
The Jays also failed to come through with runners in scoring position. In 4 games that Toronto lost, the Jays managed to hit just 114 with runners in scoring position.
When they got the runners on, or when they had runners in scoring position, I needed only 1 out to get out of the inning. You know, when you're battling to get 2 outs to get out of an inning, that can cause you some problems. But when you only need 1 out, I've always felt that I'm the best guy when it comes to getting 1 out before they can score a run.
Part of Toronto's inability to come through with runners on base had to do with the fact that the Jays' big hitters weren't producing. Fred McGriff and George Bell hit a combined 170 in the league championship series, a total that's just not good enough to win. But while Bell and McGriff were struggling at the plate, the Jays were also having problems on the mound. The starting staff went a combined 1-4 with an ERA well over 8. But the only thing the Jays had going for them in this series was their bullpen. Acker, Cerruti, Henke, and Wells saw almost 13 innings of work, but they still managed to hold the mighty A's to just 1 earned run.
I was proud to play on this team this year. Got a great bunch of guys. They worked hard. We never gave in. We never gave up. And we just kept going, kept plugging along. And you know, we got into the playoffs. A lot of people didn't think we were going to make it. I was saying a while ago, you got to take something positive home with you, I think, over the winter. You can't dwell on any of the negatives. I'm going to go home and think about, you know, hey, we did come from last place and got into first place, and we gave it our best shot, and we just fell short.
I like Oakland.
Well, you know what? I'm going to go with San Francisco. I mean, the story from Oakland was Ricky Henderson, no doubt about it. I mean, the way he got on the base and kept scoring runs because he kept advancing to second and third on steals. I think if the Giants can stop Ricky Henderson, they can stop the Oakland Athletics, because Jose Canseco has really not done very much recently.
That's sort of like saying, if you can stop Niagara Falls, then you can make all kinds of power. I mean, yeah, it's easy to say, but stopping Ricky Henderson the way he's going right now, and the same holds true for Will Clark, is a lot easier done in theory than in actuality between the two chalk lines. The reason I like Oakland so much is the reason I like them heading into the series against the Blue Jays. The simple fact that their pitching is so good. Everybody talks about the big bats, and it's easy to talk about Jose Canseco, about Mark McGwire, about Dave Parker, and I guess Ricky Henderson after this series. But not too many people talk about their pitching. I mean, but it's an outstanding staff. You look at Moore, you look at Dave Stewart, you look at the best bullpen in all of baseball, and pitching is what does it, just like defense is what does it in hockey.
But heart does it too. Last year it was L.A., this year it's going to be San Francisco.
I was talking about defense a couple of minutes ago. 10 seasons ago, the New York...
Today on Sports Desk, the series by the Bay is underway in Oakland. It's Stewart against Gorelis. In the National Hockey League, Mario Lemieux looks for goal number one as the Penguins host the Habs. And can anyone stop St. Mary's and its number one man?
Sports Desk is brought to you by Labatt's Blue. It's the way we play. Sports Desk with Chris Sedens and Gino Redden.
The last 5 days, the hype around the World Series has been incredible. 5 days of comparing hitters, pitchers, fielders, just about everything imaginable. But on Saturday, Chris, the series finally got started.
That's for sure, Gino. You know, it's being touted as the series by the Bay, the San Francisco Giants against the Oakland A's for the 1989 World Series. Both teams very explosive. The A's, they've got sluggers like McGwire and Canseco. Giants counter with Will Clark and Kevin Mitchell. The pitching matchup in game number one. For Oakland, you had Dave Stewart and Scott Geraldt on the mound for the San Francisco Giants. And this is what it's all about. The Giants against the A's for the World Series. A beautiful night in the Bay Area. As I mentioned, Dave Stewart on the mound for Oakland in game one. His second straight start to a World Series. He brings his best stuff early on. Stewart blows one by Candy Maldonado to end the second inning. And it's still scoreless. Scott Geraldt led the National League in ERA during the season, but tonight, a different story. Second inning. Tony Phillips singles off Geraldt. Dave Henderson scores on this play, and that made it 1-0 A's. Now, still in the second inning, Walt Weiss will ground the ball to Will Clark. He will try to throw Terry Steinbach out at home. Steinbach kicks the ball loose. He scores, and the A's lead 3-0 after two. Oakland adds to their lead in the third inning. Dave Parker takes Geraldt out of the ballpark. This is a solo shot for Parker. As he rounds the bases, he does the thang, as he calls it. It's 4-0 Oakland. Even the light hitting A's are showing some power here. Walt Weiss lines this ball over the right field fence, only his fourth home run of the year. The A's led 5-0 through four innings. Scott Geraldt is done for the night. It could be it for the Giants as well, because this man is doing a number on the Giants hitters. Dave Stewart, he will get Candy Maldonado to ground to Tony Phillips for the final out of this ball game. Stewart is the first A's pitcher since 1931 to throw a shutout in the World Series. The final in game one of the World Series, 5-0 Oakland over San Francisco. Dave Stewart with the complete game five-hitter.
It's one of my better games. I will always remember one game in particular against Roger Clemens here a year ago that I beat him 1-0. And that's the best game I've ever thrown in my life. Tonight ranks with one of the best I've pitched, but it's simply because it's the World Series and, you know, so many people were watching the game. But the game against the Rocket is the best I've ever pitched.
He's a very intense competitor, and he comes right after you. And you know, that's the way he did tonight. You know, you don't win 20 games for nothing. And you know, that's just the type of pitcher he is. You know, he's a great pitcher. He had command of all his pitches, and you know, he's just a tough guy to beat.
I'm definitely pleased. I thought we handled ourselves well. It was you know, Gorelitz has had a hell of a year for him, and we found a way to get some runs. Stu pitched outstanding. Yeah, I feel very good about one. It's just, it doesn't end here, and that's very, you know, that sobers you in a hurry.
We've come back all year long, so we're never out of it. But you know, we just didn't hit the ball early, and looked like a few guys were a little rusty with that 4 days off, and we didn't get the kind of hacks that we were getting against the Cubs.
On to the NHL now.
Today on Sports Desk, the great one tries to break Howe's record against his former teammates. Game two of the World Series. It's Rick Russell of the Giants against Oakland's Mike Moore. And a couple of NFL debuts, Herschel as a Viking and Bo in his first game of the season.
Sports Desk is brought to you by Canadian Airlines. Our world revolves around you. And by Labatt's Blue. It's the way we play. Sports Desk with Paul Romanek and Chris Stevens.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Sports Desk. There are two very big stories from Sunday night. One, of course, the World Series, the A's against the Giants. We will get to that in just a moment. But first, the Gretzky watch in Edmonton. Paul?
Well, somebody asked Gordie Howe the other day about Wayne Gretzky being poised to break his NHL career scoring record. When did you first get an inkling that Gretzky might do it? Somebody asked Gordie Howe. About 10 years ago, responded the grandpa. When he started having 180 and 200-point seasons, I knew my record wouldn't last all that long. So, a little over 10 years after Gretzky first started to play, he hit the ice, needing only 1 point to tie Howe, 2 points to establish the record. He did just that, and let's take a look at how he did it. Gretzky, trying to break the record, he circles around, thinking about it before the game, no doubt. And early in the first period, Gretzky along the boards will feed Bernie Nichols. And the great one is tied with Howe, 1 point, and he is alone atop the NHL all-time scoring parade. He's tied right now, still in the first. Kings 5-on-3 power play. Gretzky, all kinds of chances, but he can't click. And there's the gallery watching him. Gordie Howe in the extreme left, his parents there in the middle. Third period, Gretzky, clear view of the net. Shot knocked away. Time running down now, and watch him.
Lifting it up the glass to the line. Duchesne knocked it down, golfs it to the side of the net. Taylor to Gretzky, he scores! Wayne Gretzky has tied it and broken Gordie Howe's record.
That's the goal, 1907, and Wayne Gretzky is the new NHL all-time leading scorer.
I'd like to say in all honesty, I've been looking forward to this day. I've been spending the last 10 days with Wayne, and I thought I knew him before, but he's just grown an inch taller than what he was in my mind. A super young man, a great hockey player who shares in everything he does, and it's really nice for me to be sharing those honors with Wayne last week. Congratulations, Gordie.
As Gordie pointed out, I've been really excited the last week. I think that maybe it was only fitting that an award such as this takes a lot of teamwork and a lot of help. And both teams who are here today are definitely a big part of those 1,800 points that I've got in my career.
Oh yeah, the game. They had to go into overtime, and guess who wins it? Behind the net. Watch him. Wayne Gretzky with a couple of goals and an assist. And the LA Kings win the game by a score of 5-4. Just incredible. TSN's Ken Chilibeck was on hand at the Northlands Coliseum. He has a closer look at how the day and the evening unfolded.
Game day was a hectic one for Wayne. Some of his teammates skated. Wayne and Gordie Howe were being interviewed.
Let's go even. He arrived at Northwind's Coliseum a couple of hours before game time, and not far behind came Gordie Howe. At pregame skate, the excitement was beginning. Fans were there hoping to see history.
I'm from Calgary to see Wayne Gretzky score his big goal. And I'm excited.
And just when you thought it wouldn't happen this night, Wayne did what he's done for so many nights in the past.
To the side of the net. Taylor to Gretzky. He scored! Wayne Gretzky has tied it and broken Gordie Howe's record.
And adding the winner in overtime was just icing on the cake.
Gretzky into the slot. He backhands it in and scores! Wayne Gretzky gets the game winner. L.A. wins 5-4.
I went behind the net to be the outlet. And I just, usually I don't come in front of the net like that. And something in my mind said, you better get out in front. And I went out there. The puck came right to me. And I didn't do a whole lot. I just threw it up. And I went in the top corner. And my initial reaction was we tied the hockey game. And then Larry was right there and everyone else. And I just saw the replay on it. Just everything seemed to happen right in the same spot as when I broke Esposito's record, 77 goals, just inside the blue line against the boards there in the corner. We're all huddled there. So, you know, it was such, at that point in time, it was a real nice feeling.
In general, records are made to be broken. And if they can be broken by the type of individual that Wayne is, a sharing, caring individual who loves the game of hockey and puts 100% out for his fans every day, then in every shift, it's almost an honor to hang that over. I didn't have a heck of a lot to do with it anyway. He just took it at will, but I hope I'm around when he scores his 3,000 points.
What a storybook career. That was the 51st NHL record that he has broken now. I mean, he holds so many records in the NHL. He's such an amazing player. Only fitting it happened in Edmonton. And add to that, he scores the winner in overtime. Just unbelievable.
A great sort of sidebar to this entire thing. After the game, when Howe and Gretzky were talking, Wayne Gretzky said, I remember when I was 11 years old, I went to a hockey clinic, and you told me to work on my backhand shot. All these years later, he gets the goal that sets the new mark on a backhander. He gets the game-winning goal on a backhander.
We'll have more hockey news coming up a little later on the show. But first, let's talk some baseball. That's the other big news from Sunday night. The Oakland A's made short work of the San Francisco Giants in Game 1 of the World Series. That was Saturday. Dave Stewart pitched a 5-hit shutout in that game as the A's won the opener 5-0. Game 2 of the Fall Classic, Sunday night in Oakland. This time around, the A's sent Mike Moore to the mound. Now, this is a real culture shock for Moore. He toiled with the Seattle Mariners for 7 years, didn't have players like this in his lineup there. Carney Lansford, bottom of the first, Lansford proves his worth. Ricky Henderson on second, Lansford doubles into the right field corner. Henderson scores, it's 1-0 A's. Top of the third now, Jose Uribe on third for Robbie Thompson, and Thompson hits a sack fly to center. Uribe tags and scores. We're tied at one apiece. Bottom of the fourth now, and Oakland regains the lead. Dave Parker, the man with the big bat in the postseason, doubles off the padding just fair. Jose Canseco scores. That made it 2-1 A's. Parker is in safe at second. Two batters later, Terry Steinbach, the catcher, steps in. He faces Rick Rushell, and Steinbach will promptly park this one in the left field seats. Oakland now led 5-1. With a 4-run lead, Moore settles into a nice little groove. He pitches 7 innings, striking out 7. In the ninth, Dennis Eckersley comes in to mop up the Giants. The last out is Matt Williams at the plate, and he will ground out. And they get him at first base. A's win Game 2 of the World Series. The final score was 5-1, so Moore is the winner. Rushell takes the loss. A's lead at 2-0 now. Game 3 will be on Tuesday, Candlestick Park in San Francisco. A's manager Tony La Russa has to be very impressed with his pitching staff so far.
I thought early on, he wasn't as sharp, but he was sharp enough. And as the game went on, he got a little better feel for it. So, you know, he had to use it all today. You know, he threw some fastballs, sliders, fork balls, and you need all those things against a good hitting club. So I'm proud of him for rising to the occasion.
Seems like we're not gelling. We're not getting everything together. Guys are getting on base. We're not getting the hits. Last night, guys were getting the hits. People were getting on base. It's happened to us before. And so now we're going home. Maybe it'll make it a little easier, and we can go out there and just try to get it back.
Well, still to come on Sports Desk, action from a busy Sunday in this.
Ahead on Sports Desk, World Series Game 3 is postponed as San Francisco's hit with a serious earthquake. Pierre Paget and the North Stars look to remain undefeated. And we'll stroll back in time and reminisce with Don Quasterman.
Sports Desk is brought to you by Xerox Canada and by the Mutual Group, providing financial services for today and tomorrow. Sports Desk with Michael Landsberg and Paul Romanek.
Good evening and welcome to Sports Desk. As you have no doubt heard by now, a huge earthquake in the west coast of the U.S. in the area of San Francisco, wiping out the World Series, the biggest one, Michael, since 1906.
60,000 fans traveled to Candlestick Park in San Francisco hoping that their team could cut the Athletics World Series lead to 2-1, but a half hour before game time, the game was meaningless. Most fans were thinking about their lives. A strong earthquake struck the San Francisco area. Candlestick Park did not feel the brunt of the quake, but it was hit by it. We'll lead you through the events as they happen at Candlestick, and we're handling this as it relates to the sports story. We'll leave the news story to the news networks. This was the scene at 8:02 Eastern time at Candlestick Park. The A's and Giants preparing for Game 3 of the World Series. The earthquake started 2 minutes later, and here's what ABC was broadcasting at the time.
At second base, so the Oakland A's take.
I'll tell you what, we're having an earthquake.
And indeed, Al Michaels was correct. It was an earthquake measuring between 6.5 and 7 on the Richter scale. There's a look at the Bay Bridge. A huge trunk of the bridge has collapsed. This is a look at the highway that is approximately 10 miles north of Candlestick Park. Extensive damage very close to Candlestick Park. At least one major fire is still burning in the San Francisco area. Obviously, the game was postponed because of minor structural damage to the building. Fay Vincent, the commissioner, was now talking about whether they'd play it tomorrow.
Obviously, we need to know a lot more before we make some judgments about tomorrow night's game. It's too early for me to know whether we'll play tomorrow night. I hope so.
Obviously, the game was not on the thoughts of the players. This was a time for family. Obviously, a very frightening time at Candlestick Park as you look at some of the players and as you look at the bases being taken away. Fay Vincent still talking about what might happen.
The most important fact was the absence of light. When I saw that there was no light, it became clear to me that we had a real problem. I heard that the city was basically without power. And the most important factor to me was to get people out of this stadium during daylight. And I made the judgment to call the game when it was clear that it was unlikely that we'd have power for quite a while.
60,000 fans at Candlestick Park at that time, and many of the fans not realizing the gravity of the situation because Candlestick was not hit by the epicenter, which was approximately 60 miles south in San Jose. But here's a reaction of some of the fans and a player at Candlestick tonight.
Yes, you know, we were down on the ground, and I was over there in my locker, and I hear this noise. And I remember Don Robinson was coming in. It sounds like an earthquake. And then this thing started to really. Yeah. And I said, wait. As I said, the light went off. And you know,
the lights were going back and forth.
It went off. And I just looked for the door out. I said, I'd rather be outside. Yeah.
I dashed, ran out in the parking lot.
Who did it?
What's that? One of them was right behind me. Roger Craig ran out here, and it was scary. I've lived here my whole life, and this is the worst one I've ever felt.
Just some observations coming in afterwards from some of the managers. Tony La Russa said he was sitting in the dugout. He thought it was the fans stomping on the building that was causing the shaking. He wasn't sure. Roger Craig ran out, still had the uniform on, jumped into the family pickup truck with 8 family members, and he was gone. There was a band out playing on the field at the time. And they all started to shake around and didn't seem to know what was going on. Just reams and reams of paper coming in across with quotes and things going on around. Just an incredibly chaotic situation, as I'm sure you can appreciate if you've been watching the news reports.
Of course, the rest of the World Series is very much now in doubt as it stands in San Francisco, whether they'll be able to play there or not. You saw a slight crack. Apparently, there are larger cracks than that. You saw a piece of cement that one of the fans had picked up. So there's a question of whether or not the building is safe. And there's also a much more important issue, and we're not trying to avoid the fact that this is a most serious situation in San Francisco, but we're trying to deal with this as it relates to the sports story. You're getting other information from other sources regarding the news side. There's a question of whether or not the area of San Francisco would be able to have an event like this right now. They're thinking about survival right now and not the World Series.
And I didn't hear anything about whether the Oakland Stadium was damaged structurally or not. That, of course, would be the last concern of the people in San Francisco right now. They're trying to clean up. Again, if you've seen the news reports, it's just a mess down there. And you can tune into the news networks a little bit later on for lots more on that.
It was most interesting to watch how it unfolded. At the beginning, when you heard from people at the ballpark, they were saying, it's an earthquake, and they were laughing and they were smiling because no one was maybe not hurt at all and certainly not seriously hurt. And then you start to realize, hey, this was not the center of the earthquake. There is a disastrous situation out there.
I mean, it could have been just awful, obviously, if the entire state, if the epicenter...
Game 3 of the World Series has been postponed and will be rescheduled at a later date. Stay tuned now for ABC's regular Wednesday night lineup, featuring all new episodes of Growing Pains, Head of the Class, Doogie Howser, M.D., and Anything But Love. Followed at 10, 9 Central by an ABC News special, The Great Quake of 89, with Peter Jennings.
So what we have is a stock...
From New York, Forrest Sawyer.
Good evening. There is news from the sports world in the aftermath of that earthquake that rocked Northern California late yesterday afternoon. You recall that it struck Northern California just before the start of World Series Game 3. They have now decided when the series will resume. At the earliest, it will be next Tuesday night in Candlestick Park, according to Baseball Commissioner Faye Vincent. They believe that Games 3 and 4 will be played there. Game 5, if necessary, will be in San Francisco. They would like it to be in Oakland. Later tonight at 10 o'clock, Peter Jennings will bring you a special report, The Great Quake of 1989. I'm Forrest Sawyer in New York. Good night.
Only 2 seconds remain. Timeout Giants, 6-yard gain.
Reporting live from San Francisco, where in progress right now is a press conference with the baseball commissioner, Faye Vincent, the mayor of San Francisco, Art Agnos, in regard to the resumption of the World Series, which was originally scheduled to resume Tuesday at Candlestick Park at 5:30 in the afternoon, but now has been pushed back. And they have firmly committed to the resumption of the World Series on Friday night, this coming Friday night, at 5:30 Pacific time at Candlestick Park. Game 3 then, Game 4 Saturday at the same time at Candlestick. If a fifth game is necessary, Sunday at Candlestick Park at approximately 5:30. Monday would be an off day, and if the series needs to be resumed, if a sixth and or seventh game are necessary, back to the Oakland Coliseum the following Tuesday and Wednesday. A lot of questions still to be answered, in particular in regard to the traffic flow and the movement throughout the Bay Area tomorrow, which is really the first work day, the first day that many, many people are anticipated to return to their offices to attempt to traverse the Bay Area. And I think that the mayor, along with the commissioner, obviously felt that it might have been a little too early, jumping the gun a little too quickly, to attempt to get things ready and in place for an orderly flow to Candlestick Park, among other things, on Tuesday. So it has been pushed back further another 3 days, with Game 3 now scheduled, and they say firmly, Friday at Candlestick Park, Game 3 of the World Series between the Giants and the A's. A little later, we hope to be back with both the commissioner, Faye Vincent, and the mayor of San Francisco, Art Agnos. For the moment, that is the story from San Francisco. Now let's go to Jim McKay in Laurel, Maryland.
Thank you very much. That's Al Michaels, of course, who's been doing such a knowledgeable and compassionate job of reporting ever since the earthquake occurred in San Francisco. The subject here today is horse racing.
Park shortly after 5 o'clock, as originally anticipated, but instead, Game 3 will be held Friday at Candlestick Park at roughly 5:30 in the afternoon, a fourth game on Saturday, a fifth game on Sunday, if necessary, games 6 and 7. back to Oakland next Tuesday and Wednesday. The mayor of San Francisco, Art Agnos, is with me. Mr. Mayor, what were the primary considerations in regard to deciding that Friday would be the better startup day?
Well, there were several. First and foremost, we had to have ironclad guarantee that the Candlestick Stadium would be safe for the fans to come and watch the ball game. And we'll get the final reports tonight and early tomorrow morning that will give us that ironclad guarantee. Secondly, we're looking at some monumental traffic jams that will begin tomorrow morning with the rush hour traffic and obviously continue with the evening traffic that night. And we wanted the 4 to 5 days to work out the rough spots as we deal with that. It's never happened before, obviously, to have a major artery like the bridge. And so once we have those in place, we think that we're ready to move, and Friday would be the perfect time to do that. Life has to go on, Al, and we're ready to do that. The people of this city and this area are resilient, and we're going to prove that starting this week coming.
And of course, with the mayor today was the commissioner of baseball, Faye Vincent. Your reaction on behalf of baseball?
Well, I think baseball is delighted to be able to play in San Francisco. We like the idea of having a definite date, and we're thrilled that the mayor has been so supportive.
Gentlemen, we'll see you on Friday at Candlestick Park, and right now we'll send you back to Jim McKay.
Well, we're back, and there is still...
Today on Sports Desk, Baseball Commissioner Faye Vincent announces the future of the World Series. A hard-hitting battle for second spot in the CFL West. Senna versus Prost. They take their feud to the racetrack in Japan.
Sports Desk is brought to you by Mazda. The cars and trucks backed by the best warranty in the business. That's the Mazda way. Sports Desk with Michael Landsberg.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to our show. If you've been out and about and enjoying your Sunday and you're saying, what happened in sport? Well, you've turned to the right place. Full recap over the next half hour with plenty of highlights. San Francisco is recovering. The people of that city will never forget Tuesday's earthquake. Some will remember it because of the tragedy it brought. Others will remember it because it gave them the scare of their lives. But regardless, they all say that life must go on. And one of the ways that that can be done is to start enjoying life again with things like the World Series. The mayor of San Francisco held a joint news conference with the commissioner of baseball a little over an hour ago to announce plans for the World Series. They had said it would resume at its earliest on Tuesday. They've now pushed that back 3 days to Friday.
I'd like to announce that we are going to play at Candlestick starting Friday night, Saturday, and Sunday. And we will go to Oakland, if necessary, Tuesday and Wednesday. That schedule is now set. The great attraction of all this, I might say to you, from baseball's point of view, is that we have the comfort of knowing that the community is pleased with our resuming baseball. I said to you, I thought it was important for baseball to know its place. I think we have found the right place. And the definite schedule is very attractive to us because we can now plan to play on Friday, and I think we will have met the mayor's expectations in terms of traffic.
There's no real interest at the top or the bottom of the CFL West, but
we're committed to making a start for our family. And
on Sports Desk, the long delay is over and the San Francisco Giants try to cut Oakland's lead in the World Series. Does anyone want to walk into the Lions' den? The BC Lions are for sale again. And the Los Angeles Kings get the task of stopping Winnipeg's big run.
Is brought to you by Canadian Airlines. Our world revolves around you. And by Labatt's Blue. It's the way we play. Sports Desk with Paul Romanek and Mark Jones.
Well, we're going to kick off the beginning of a great weekend in sports. There's news from the Canadian Football League as they hang the for sale sign up on the BC Lions one more time.
Again?
one more time, yeah, and who knows. We've got the highlights from the NHL, including the Canucks at Calgary, but
Paul, we begin with baseball and the World Series. I guess that will always be remembered for the series that featured the earthquake.
The long layoff, a game that just didn't make sense. Game three, pitchers are supposed to dominate hitters after a long layoff. That's just the way it's supposed to go. They always talk about that during spring training. The Oakland A's on the way to game three got stuck in traffic and missed most of their batting practice. So San Francisco pitchers obliged by throwing a little bit of batting practice for them in the early part of the game. Oakland all over the San Francisco pitching, led by the big guy, Jose Canseco, 0 for 22 in the World Series career, and he breaks out of that slump right here. Carney Lansford goes to second. Jose's on with a single. Another man who was slumping in series play a little bit was Dave Henderson, but with men on second and third, cue Dave to break out of the slump right there. Cranking one off the top of the wall. That's a double. Lansford and Canseco score. Henderson has a double. The A's are up 2-0, and the rout has just started. On to the fourth. Dave Henderson at the plate again. And this time he punches it just a little bit more, and bye-bye, a solo shot. The A's are up 3-1, and Henderson is just starting to loosen up. The Giants make it close in the bottom of the fourth, briefly. Terry Kennedy with a single. Will Clark and Kevin Mitchell come around to count. It's now 4-3, A's on top, but that's about as close as things get. Fifth inning, 2-1 for Jose Canseco, and bombs away Jose. It is 7-3, Oakland, after that swat. And the next batter is Dave Henderson. Yeah, this same Dave Henderson who was slumping a little bit in World Series play. You can say bye-bye, baby, to this one. His second home run of the game. Only the sixth man in series history to hit homers in back-to-back innings. And then in the sixth inning, Carney Lansford. Hits it in the air to left field and deep, and going back is Mitchell. That's the fifth home run of the game for the A's. That sets a series record. That made it 9-3, and when the curtain comes down, 13-7. No, this is not the Oakland Raiders and the San Francisco 49ers. Not a football score, a baseball score. 13-7, the final. Oakland with some incredible offense led by the incredible Dave Henderson.
Well, I think it's very important when you get a two-out hit and, you know, you put the Giants down two runs right off the bat in the first inning. They say, here we go again. We got to score three runs off Dave Stewart, which is tough. And with our offense, we got a chance to tack on two, three, four, five runs, and you don't want to get down early against our ace.
This guy loves that situation where there's a lot of pressure. He loves to hit the ninth inning. He probably, I think, has gotten more hits, more home runs to win games and extra innings the last two or three years than anybody in baseball. He loves that situation. I think the thing we all saw about Dave Henderson this year was the first 3 months when we were trying to grind out some wins playing short, and he went out there sore, fatigued, and he still played well. So the guy is such a good player. He's a great center fielder. I don't think he gets enough credit for that. He, you know, he's got a great arm, great hands, pays attention, and he loves to hit in the clutch.
This game can humble you in a minute. You never know what's going to happen. Nobody expected 20 runs today after the long layoff, and that's what happened. But we've got a pitcher pitching tomorrow with a lot of heart, and I got a ball club out there with a lot of heart.
I don't try to do anything fancy. You know, as Roger Craig said, scout reports are true when I'm out there. I don't do anything different. I'm the same pitcher all the time, and I'm going to win or I'm going to lose with the same stuff. That's the way I believe in pitching.
Well, Jose Canseco is often the target of derisive comments from opposing fans, and in a strange way, I guess, that's kind of flattering for Jose. He usually bites his tongue and doesn't respond to the catcalls, preferring instead to let his bat do his talking for him. But Friday, Jose had had enough.
It seems like fans always get on me, especially in opposing ballparks. It's really nothing of a big change, but when that happens, you get the younger kids who have been drinking, or the younger guys, or the older guys, but I've never really gotten an older, mature lady somewhere from 50 to 60 years old really get on me the way she did. And the funny part about it was she was saying so many things, and I just sort of told her to shut up and be quiet. And I don't know if it was her son or someone sitting beside her, a younger gentleman, anywhere from 15 to 20 years old, said, Jose, have some class. I mean, what am I supposed to do? You're talking about an older lady saying all these profanities. I'm just supposed to shut up and just not say anything.
An Oakland sportscaster had the great line of Jose Canseco. He's got that phone-in hotline, the 1-900 number down there. This Oakland sportscaster says, here's a guy who thinks that Debbie Does Dallas was a baseball movie. Why do we want to pay $5 a minute to hear his thoughts?
He does carry a big stick, though. A record night for the Oakland A's. Five home runs is a record. A total of seven combined by the both teams is also a record. And Ricky Henderson's 11 stolen bases breaks Davey Loeb's record, and I guess it's just a matter of time before this is over.
Is it over?
The fat lady is warming up the cords right now.
She's humming. Vancouver and Calgary.
Rain hitter division battle. And the Eskimos go after a CFL record 15th win of the season.
Desk is brought to you by Labatt's Blue. It's the way we play. Sports Desk with Paul Romanek and Gino Retta.
Hello, everyone. Nice to have you with us. To win the World Series, the San Francisco Giants would have to make Major League Baseball history. No team has ever come back to win the World Series after being down 3-0. And Paul, considering the way the Oakland Athletics have been playing,
nobody was going to.
Oakland winning 9-6, the 14th time that a team has swept the World Series. Didn't the Giants kind of remind you a lot of the A's in last year's series, all those big bats doing nothing? Remember Parker, McGuire, Canseco, a combined 5-for-51. This time around, though, Oakland pitching, giant killers. The San Francisco Big Three of Clark, Mitchell, and Williams, a combined 5-for-49 in a nutshell. That being the story. Those guys didn't come through. Guys like Ricky Henderson did. Henderson at the plate here, the first pitch of the game, and bye-bye. See you later. 8 separate A's with home runs. That's a World Series record. First at-bat of the game and a home run. On to the second inning we go, and Mike Moore is at the plate. Two on, two out, and Moore, a pitcher, belts it like a career 350 hitter. Henderson and Walt Weiss come in to score. Moore's first hit ever, the first time a pitcher has gotten a hit in the series, an American League pitcher since 79. Here's Ricky Henderson. The hit parade continues. Brings in Moore with the single. 4-0 A's in the second. And that will get Roger Craig up and across the chalk line to make a pitching change. No San Francisco starter lasted through 5 innings. Conversely, the A's starters like Mike Moore, smoking. He freezes Matt Williams with that pitch. Ricky Henderson continuing to shine for the Oakland A's as he did against the Blue Jays in the ALCS, punching this one. Now, for pretty much anybody, a hit like that is a double, no problem. But for Henderson, crank it up. And hello, triple. 8-0 for the A's. Henderson with a home run, a triple, and a single. The Giants, though, get something going in the seventh. Greg Litton, gone. And suddenly it is 8-4. Still in the seventh inning, the Giants down by a pair. One on for Kevin Mitchell. This will tie it. Well, it would have tied it. Still 8-6. The A's hold on. Brett Butler grounds out, and this will do it. Nine to six, the final score. Oakland over top of San Francisco. The Oakland A's absolutely awesome offensively. Pitching wise, Dave Stewart was amazing. So was Mike Moore. Stewart, you knew he was the MVP.
The series being played here, definitely I feel something different for winning it, being in my hometown and playing for my home team.
Oh, I love it. You know, it's a great feeling. You know, it's a great opportunity that I got to, you know, be Oakland A's and to get to the World Series. I think when I was traded from the Oakland A's and went to New York, I thought I was going to get this chance, and it so happened I didn't get the chance. I had to come back home to get it.
This is what it's all about. I mean, you know, coming to the World Series is great your first time, but after you lose a couple of them, you realize there's nothing like winning the World Series. And now I can go home and brag and say I'm the world champ, you know. And I was out there and I had something to do with it. And I'm champion of the world.
I'm telling you, you know what happens is you're in the clubhouse and people get a little carried away a little too soon, especially, you know, setting up for all this stuff here. And all I could think about is sitting on the bench like, oh, God, you know, don't get this thing too close. And Mitchell almost tied it up, but luckily we won.
I really believe that at least in the World Series, we showed the world how good a ball club we have. Last year, Dodgers took it away from us, but this year we pushed all year long to get to this point, and now we've got that last piece.
Anytime you're in a situation like this with this much media, this much attention, this much pressure, you can always benefit from it. And so hopefully the guys will take the experience that they had and take it into 1990.
And the big difference, I think, for the Oakland A's from 1 year ago, number one, they were able to hit the pitching, which they couldn't do against the Dodgers, but two guys, Ricky Henderson and Mike Moore. Moore coming down from Seattle made the pitching staff just that much deeper. You saw what he did in the series. And Henderson, do you have to tell anybody what that guy's capable
yeah, no
of?
No kidding. Offensively, 32-14, the Giants were outscored by the A's. I mean, unbelievable. The A's never trailed in the series. They've won every game by at least three runs. I mean, their offense was just incredible.
And again, the Henderson factor coming into play. His on-base percentage was 411 when he came over in the trade, and he just carried that right through the postseason. You get him on with a walk or a single, it's an automatic double or triple. He killed the Jays, and he did the same thing in the series.
Interesting note, out of respect for the victims of the earthquake, no champagne in the locker room.
Series, it will be a little more than a footnote, sort of officially wrapping up in Oakland on Monday. The wrap-up, not the traditional parade, but just a rally, the low-key rally. And even the post-game celebrations, you may recall, where they didn't have any champagne in deference to the victims and families of the victims of the earthquake. The people that did come out, pretty enthusiastic, behind their team, brightening things up in an atmosphere that was pretty bleak for a while. The A's held together. They won it in style with great, great talent.
Well, I know we've all heard that the longer you have to wait for something, the more it means to you. And nobody liked the reason that we had to wait so long to be the world champions, but I know it means a great deal to all of us.
But I've been through three of these things in the last 4 years, and you don't know what this means to me personally, that I finally got over the hump and won this thing. Thank you.
I know we've all waited a long time. I know I've waited 7 years with the A's and 5 years before that, and I know I speak for the whole team when I say that after last year's disappointing loss to the Dodgers, that the most gratifying part about winning this year was showing the whole world what the A's are really like. Thank you.
I'd like to say from the bottom of my heart that to me, Oakland and the Oakland A's have a lot in common. And that one thing is that the green always rises.